Hi my dear students, welcome back to the class. So far we were discussing about three-dimensional geometry, isn't it? We discussed several concepts regarding three-dimensional geometry. Also we discussed several concepts regarding lines, planes, etc. We derived equation of planes in different situations, like when it passes through a point and parallel to a vector, when it passes through three non-collinear points, etc. in the previous class. Today we are going to discuss about the equation of a plane which passes through intersection of two given planes. Suppose that we are provided with two planes and we are going to find the equation of a new plane which passes through the intersection of those two planes, which means that the new plane is included in both the plane, or the new plane touches both the plane in a single line. So let us consider the case. Let pi 1 and pi 2 be the first two planes. Let the equation of the pi 1 be r dot n 1 cap is equal to d 1, where n 1 cap is the unit normal vector to the first plane and d 1 is the distance of the first plane from the origin. Of course, r is an arbitrary point in the plane. Let pi 2 be, we know the standard form of the equation of a plane is of this form, we derived in the previous class, r2 pi 2 be r dot n2 cap is equal to d2, where n2 cap is the unit, we know that n cap is the unit vector, so n2 cap is the unit normal vector to the plane pi 2, and d2 is the distance of the plane from the origin, that's it. So we have pi 1 and pi 2. Now, suppose that we are provided with a new plane pi 3, which is in the intersection of these two planes. Suppose that we are provided with a new plane pi 3, which is in the intersection of these two planes, which means that pi 3 is originated, or pi 3 stands in the intersection of those two planes, or in a line connecting those two planes. Okay, let it be there. So pi 3 is in the intersection of these two planes. We have to derive the equation of pi 3. Since pi 3 is in the intersection of these two planes, pi 3 must satisfy these two equations, isn't it? Let t be any arbitrary point in pi 3, then t must satisfy this equation. So t dot n1 cap must be equal to d1, as well as t dot n2 cap must be equal to d2. Why? Because t is an arbitrary point in pi 3, and pi 3 is in the intersection of, pi 3 is included in the intersection of these two planes. So we must have, t must satisfy, or any arbitrary point in the plane pi 3 must satisfy equation 1 and equation 2. Okay, now we have this equation. We shall name this equation as 4 and this equation as 3. We shall multiply equation number 4 with lambda to get lambda t n2 cap equal to lambda into d2. So this is equation number 5. What we have done is we just multiplied the equation number 4 with a constant lambda. Now we are going to add equation number 3 and equation number 5 to get a new equation. We multiplied this equation with a lambda in order to show that this equation is valid for, or this derivation is valid for, all the planes which are parallel to this plane. We can have infinitely many planes parallel to a single plane. So we are deriving a general condition, and we have multiplied the entire equation of the plane with a lambda in order to show that this derivation is equal to all the planes parallel to that a single plane. So we have lambda into tn2 cap is equal to lambda d2. Let it be equation number 5. Then we are going to add equation number 3 and equation number 5. Okay. So equation number 3 is equal to this and equation number 5 is equal to this. We can take t common, so it will become vector t into, what all things we have, can have equation 3 and equation 5, n1 plus lambda n2, n1 plus lambda n2 is equal to, look at the right hand side, d1 plus lambda d2. Now observe that T is an R position vector of an arbitrary point in the plane pi 3. But where is pi 3? Pi 3 is in the intersection of these two planes, which means that here we have chosen the arbitrary point as R, and here we have chosen the arbitrary point as T in the plane pi 3. But pi 3 is situated in the intersection of these two planes, which means that we can replace T by R itself, because every point or an arbitrary point in pi 1 and pi 2 will be an arbitrary point in pi 3, because pi 3 is there in the intersection of the first two planes, isn't it? So we can replace T by R, so the equation becomes R dot n1 plus lambda n2 is equal to d1 plus lambda d2. So this will be the vector equation of a plane which is in the intersection of two other planes, with equations R dot n1 cap equal to d1, R dot n2 cap equal to d2. So in order to find the equation of a plane which is in the intersection of another two planes, just observe the two given planes. If R dot n1 equal to d1 and R dot n2 equal to d2 is the original planes, just identify n1 cap, n2 cap and put it here. Also identify d1 and d2 and put it here to get the vector equation of the plane. Now suppose that we have to derive the Cartesian form. Suppose that we are provided with two planes, R dot n1 cap is equal to d1 and R dot n2 cap is equal to d2, where d1 is the perpendicular distance from the origin to the plane, d2 is the perpendicular distance from the origin to the second plane, and n1 and n2 like this. Suppose that in order to derive the Cartesian form, suppose that n1 cap is equal to a1 I cap plus b1 j cap plus c1 k cap. And let n2 cap is equal to a2 I cap plus b2 j cap plus c2 k cap, where n1 is the unit vector in the perpendicular to pi 1, okay, unit normal vector. Now n2 cap is the unit vector perpendicular to pi 2. Don't forget that that result. N1 and n2, always remember d1 and d2 is the perpendicular distance from the origin to the plane, whereas n1 and n2 are the unit vector perpendicular to the respective planes. Let it be there. So we have n1 and n2 like this, and let the arbitrary line be, arbitrary vector be, arbitrary the position vector of the arbitrary point be xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap. So this was our required conditions in order to derive the Cartesian form from this condition. So on substituting all these terms, we can find that the form will be, the equation will be of the form x into a1 plus lambda a2 plus y into b1 plus lambda b2 plus z into c1 plus lambda c2 is equal to d1 plus lambda d2. What happened here? We just substituted all the terms and we associated the respective term. The first component of x, r is x. The first component of n1 is a1. The first component of n2 is a2. So we associated it to in a single step. നമുക്ക് ഒരുപാട് സ്റ്റെപ്പ് ഇത് ചെയ്യാം. നേരെ സബ്സ്റ്റിറ്റ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുക, ഡോട്ട് പ്രൊഡക്റ്റ് കാണുക, അസോസിയേറ്റ് ചെയ്യുക. അതെല്ലാം നമ്മൾ ഒന്നിച്ചങ്ങ് ചെയ്താണ്. വി ജസ്റ്റ് ഐഡന്റിഫൈഡ് ദ ഫസ്റ്റ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് ആർ, ദ ഫസ്റ്റ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ വൺ, ദ ഫസ്റ്റ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ ടു. സിമിലർലി ദ സെക്കൻഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് ആർ, ദ സെക്കൻഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ, ദ സെക്കൻഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ ടു. ആൻഡ് സിമിലർലി ദ തേർഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് ആർ, ദ തേർഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ വൺ, ആൻഡ് ദ തേർഡ് കമ്പോണന്റ് ഓഫ് എൻ ടു. ആൻഡ് അറ്റ് ദ ലാസ്റ്റ് വി റിട്ടൺ ദ റൈറ്റ് ഹാൻഡ് സൈഡ് ഓൾസോ. Now we can simplify the entire result into a simple form, that is a1x plus b1y plus c1z. So we written a1x b1y c1z plus lambda into, so then plus lambda into a1x, sorry, a2x, see, lambda into a2x plus b2y plus c2z equal to d1 plus lambda d2 will be the Cartesian equation of the plane which passes through no, not passes through, which is perpendicular to the unit vector n1 is equal to a1 i cap plus v1 j cap plus e1 k cap, n2 is equal to a2 i cap plus b2 j cap plus c2 k cap, and the arbitrary point in both the vectors, both the planes is xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap. So remember this equation very well, and always remember what is a1 b1 c1, a2 b2 c2, and d1 and d2. D1 is the perpendicular distance from the origin to the first plane, d2 is the distance from the origin from the to the second plane. So this equation will represent the Cartesian equation of the plane which is in the intersection of two planes pi 1 and pi 2 with the equations 1 and 2. So now we shall move on to the example number 20 of your textbook. The question is, find the vector equation of the plane passing through the intersection of planes r dot I cap plus j cap plus k cap equal to 6 and r dot 2i cap plus 3j cap plus 4 cap equal to minus 5 and the point 1, 1, 1. So, we are given with a plane and we are given with two planes. We have to find the equation of the plane which is in the intersection of these two planes. We know that whenever we are given with two planes, say r dot n cap is equal to d and r dot n1 cap equal to d1 and r dot n2 cap is equal to d2, then the equation of the plane which passes through the intersection of those two planes will be r dot n1 cap plus lambda n2 cap is equal to d1 plus lambda d2. We learned this in the previous session, isn't it? So now we have n1 cap and n2 cap. Also we have d1 6, d2 minus 5. Substituting all these quantities together, we get r dot I cap plus j cap plus k cap plus lambda into, so this will be a square bracket, lambda into 2i cap plus 3j cap plus 4k cap is equal to, what is d1? D1 is equal to 6 plus lambda d2. What is d2? D2 is equal to minus 5. So minus 5 lambda. So we get an equation like this. We shall name this equation as equation number 1. Now we are given with a point 1, 1, 1 on it, and we know that r is an arbitrary point in it. We can substitute r is equal to xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap in equation number 1, because r is an arbitrary point which is equal to x, y, z. So position vector of that arbitrary point will be xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap, isn't it? Now we shall substitute this quantity into equation number 1. We will get xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap dot I cap plus, we shall associate all the terms containing I cap together in that, then it will be easier for us to find the cross product. So we have 1 plus 2 lambda into I cap, 1 plus 2 lambda plus 1 plus 3 lambda into j cap, 1 plus 3 lambda into j cap plus 1 plus 4 lambda into k cap, into k cap is equal to 6 minus 5 lambda. Okay, now we can easily find the dot product. Just multiply the respective components together and add them together, we will get the cross dot product, isn't it? We learned that in the vector algebra. So it will become 1 plus 2 lambda into x plus 1 plus 3 lambda into y plus 1 plus 4 lambda into z equal to 6 minus 5 lambda. Okay, now it is given that 1, 1, 1 will be a point in the plane. So we can substitute 1, 1, 1 instead of x, y and z to get lambda. See, lambda is an unknown quantity till now. So we have to evaluate lambda from the given condition. So I am going to substitute 1, 1, 1 into equation number 2. So the equation number 2 will become 1 plus 2 lambda plus 1 plus 3 lambda plus 1 plus 4 lambda is equal to 6 minus 5 lambda. So it is equal to 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 3. 3 plus 2 lambda plus 3 lambda equal to 5 lambda. 5 lambda plus 4 lambda is equal to 9 lambda. So 3 plus 9 lambda is equal to 6 minus 5 lambda. Okay. Now we can find easily we can find lambda as 14 lambda. 9 plus 5, 14. Lambda is equal to 6 minus 3. 3, 6 minus 3 is equal to 3. So lambda equal to 3 by 14. So we obtained lambda as 3 by 14. Now we shall substitute the value of lambda in this equation in order to make the equation of the plane into a standard form. So on substituting lambda is equal to 3 by 14. We are going to substitute that lambda in this equation. Let this equation be A. So in A, we will get? So see, this is nothing but R. Vector R dot. What will be this? 1 plus 2 into 3 by 14. 3 by 14 plus 1 plus, what is this equation? Okay, plus into I cap plus 1 plus 3 into 3 by 14 into J cap plus 1 plus 4 into 3 by 14 into K cap is equal to what? 6 minus 5 into 3 by 14. So this will be the equation of the plane. We have to simplify this equation. So it will become R dot 1 plus 2 by 14 is nothing but 1 plus 3 by 7. We can cancel 2 and 14. I cap plus 1 plus 3 by 14. So it will become 9 by 14. J cap plus, we can cancel 4 and 14 together to get 6 by 14. 1 plus 6 by 14. K cap. It is equal to 6 minus 15 by 14. Okay. So this is our equation of the plane. Now you have to simplify it further to get the standard equation. Now on simplifying it further, the equation will become R dot. What is this? 10 by 7 I cap plus 14 plus 9 is nothing but 23 by 14 J cap plus 14 plus 12 is nothing but 26 by 14 K cap into, this will be a square bracket, so it will be into R. So R dot, this vector is equal to, when we simplify this, this will result in 69 by 14. So this is the vector equation of the plane which passes through the intersection of these two planes. We can further simplify it also. We can cancel 14 from the denominator so that the equation will become R dot. We can make the denominator 14 by multiplying the numerator and the denominator of this fraction with the 2. So it will become 20 I cap plus 23 J cap plus 26 K cap is equal to 69. Here we have cancelled 14 from the numerator of left denominator of left and right side. Now you can see that this is the vector equation of the plane. Now you can easily convert, or we can easily find out the Cartesian equation of the plane just by substituting R is equal to xi cap plus yj cap plus zk cap into this equation. Now we shall discuss about the coplanarity of two lines. We can say that two lines are coplanar only if those two lines should lie on the same plane, which means that whenever two lines are not in the same plane, we cannot say the two lines are coplanar. So in order to say two lines to be coplanar, they must lie on the same line. Suppose that we are given with two lines, R is equal to A1 plus lambda B1 and R is equal to A2 plus mu B2 be the two lines, which means that R1 passes through the point A1, passes through a point say A with the position vector A1 and parallel to the vector B1, and R, the second line, this is the first line and this is the second line, and the second line passes through the point say B and it is parallel to the vector b2. Then we can say that since R, this line passes through A and the second line passes through B, then we can say that the line or the vector AB will lie on the plane if it is coplanar. The vector AB will be on the same plane if it is coplanar, because A1 and A2 are the points by which the lines passes, and if AB, those points, the vector connecting those points is also in the same plane, then we can say that these two lines is in the same plane, isn't it? But AB is nothing but what? Vector A2 minus vector A1, isn't it? We know that by triangular law of equation, AB is nothing but A2 minus A1. So let it be there. Now we know that B1 is a vector parallel to the first line, and B2 is the vector parallel to the second line. Then B1 cross B2 will be perpendicular to both B1 and B2, isn't it? So B1 cross B2 will be perpendicular to both B1 and B2. Also note that A2 minus A1 and B1 cross B2 must be perpendicular in order to these two lines to be in the same plane, because we know that B1 and B2 are the vectors parallel to first line and second line respectively. Also A1 and A2 are the points by which the lines passes, isn't it? From that we can say that AB is equal to A2 minus A1 will be a vector in the same plane. Also B1 and B2 is also in the same plane, but we know that B1 cross B2 is perpendicular to B1 and B2. Therefore, B1 cross B2 must be perpendicular to A2 minus A1 also. Therefore, in order for these two lines to be coplanar, A2 minus A1 dot B1 cross B2 must be is equal to 0. So, this is the condition for coplanarity of two lines given by this equation. What is that? A2 minus A1 dot B1 cross B2, B2 cross B1, whatever it is, must be equal to 0. Why? Because, let me explain once again, because we know that A1 and A2 lies in the given two lines, isn't it? So A2 minus A1, in order to these two lines to be coplanar, A2 minus A1 should be also in the same plane, isn't it? Now, B1 and B2 are the parallel vectors to these two lines. So, in order for these two lines to be coplanar, AB and B1 and B2 should also lie in the same plane. Now, we know that B1 cross B2 is perpendicular to both B1 and B2. So, in order for these two lines to be coplanar, A2 minus A1 and B1 cross B2 must be perpendicular. If it is perpendicular, the dot product will be 0. Hence, by that intuition, we made the condition for two lines given by the equations to be coplanar. Now, in order to derive the Cartesian form, suppose that the position vector A1 is equal to x1 I cap plus y1 j cap plus z1 k cap, and let the position vector A2 is equal to x2 I cap plus y2 j cap plus z2 k cap. So we marked A1 and A2 into the Cartesian form in order to derive the Cartesian equation of this condition. Okay, so this is the vector equation, don't forget it, this is very important. Now we are going to derive the Cartesian equation. In order to derive the Cartesian equation, we first named the points or the position vectors A1 and A2 by the Cartesian coordinate system. Okay, let it be there. Now we have A1 and A2. Now let B1 is equal to vector B1 is equal to A1 I cap plus A2 j cap. No need. B1 I cap. A1 I cap plus B1 j cap plus C1 k cap. And let vector B2 is equal to A2 I cap plus B2 j cap plus C2 k cap. So we defined all the necessary items in this equation to derive the vector equation. See, very easily we know that A2 minus A1. So A2 minus A1 is equal to what is A2 minus A1? X2 minus X1 I cap. X2 minus X1 I cap plus Y2 minus Y1 J cap plus Z2 minus z1 k cap. It's very simple because we named a1 by this vector equation and a2 by this vector equation. So we get a2 minus a1 like this. Okay. Now, what is b1 cross b2? We can easily find b1 cross b2 using the cross product formula, the determinant formula. And after that, we can find the dot product also. So after all these process, we will get the Cartesian equation as determinant x2 minus x1, y2 minus y1, z2 minus z1. And then we have a1, b1, c1. A1, b1, c1. Then we have a2, b2, c2. A2, b2, c2 must be equal to 0. So this is the Cartesian equation of the equation of the condition of coplanarity of two lines. What we have done is we just substituted a2 minus a1 b1 cross b2 into this equation. So we got this as the condition of coplanarity of two lines. If you have any doubt on about the derivation of this equation, just do this. Just substitute a2 minus a1 and b1 cross b2 into this vector equation. We know that we can easily find the dot product just by simply by multiplying the respective components and deriving the equation, and the finally obtained equation is nothing but this determinant. Now we shall find the distance of a point from a plane. Suppose that we are provided with a plane π1 like this. This is our provided plane, and suppose that P, this is our given point. So we have to find the distance of P from this plane π1. So in order to find the distance of P from the plane π1, I first constructed a plane consisting of the point P, or constructed a plane including the point P which is parallel to π1. So π1 and π2 are nothing but parallel plane, and the speciality of π2 is that π2 includes the given point P. Now we have to find the distance between P and this π1. Okay. Now let A bar be the position vector of the point P, and let R dot n cap is equal to D be the equation of the plane π1. So this is nothing but the equation of the plane π1. We know that the equation of the plane is of the form this, and π1 is given to us. So the equation of the plane π1 is also given to us. So this is the equation. Also suppose that A is the position vector of P. Now we are going to find the distance between P and the plane π1 in a special manner. Just observe it very well. Now we know that R represent an arbitrary point in the plane. Since this plane is also parallel to π1, we can use R to represent an arbitrary point in the plane π2 also. Therefore, let we have n cap is the point in the another point in the plane which is an arbitrary point, and the position vector of n be R bar. So n prime is an arbitrary point in this plane π2 which we have constructed, which includes the point P and parallel to π1. Also note that n, the position vector of n is an arbitrary point, is denoted by the vector R. So we have this, and A bar is this. So we have n prime P is nothing but R minus A, isn't it? So n prime P is nothing but R minus A. Also note that n cap is perpendicular, unit vector perpendicular to π1. Since π1 is parallel to π2, it implies n cap is perpendicular to π2 also, isn't it? Since n cap is perpendicular to π2 and n prime P is a line segment in the plane π2, we have n cap dot n prime P is nothing but R minus A. R minus A is equal to 0, isn't it? That implies R dot n cap minus n cap dot A is equal to 0, which implies R dot n cap is equal to n cap dot A, isn't it? See, this is of the form R dot n cap is equal to D, where D is nothing but n cap dot A, isn't it? So n cap dot A mod n cap dot a will be the distance of the plane pi 2 from origin. Why? Because we know that when we are given with an equation of a plane like this, this d actually represent, mod d actually represent the distance of the plane from the origin. Here we have, instead of d, we have n cap dot a. Therefore, n cap dot a will be the distance of the plane from the origin. Okay, so that's it. We get n cap dot a as a distance of pi 2 from origin. Now we are going to find the distance between the point P and the plane Q. Now you know that d is actually the distance of the origin and the plane, since this equation is represents plane pi 1, and n cap mod n cap dot a represents the distance of the origin and the plane pi 2. Therefore, the distance in between them is nothing but d minus modulus of d minus n cap dot a. See why we done this? Because d is this, mod d is actually this distance, and mod n cap dot a is this distance. So the distance in between them is mod d minus n cap dot a. Okay, now mod d minus n cap dot a is nothing but the distance between two parallel planes. Therefore, it will be the distance between the point P and the plane pi 1. So we have d is equal to d prime, which means distance between the point P and the plane pi 1 is nothing but d minus n cap dot a, where d is the distance of the point pi 1 from the origin, plane pi 1 from the origin, and a is the position vector of the given point, which are given to us. So this is the distance d. Now note that we have the distance between a point and a plane is given by this equation. We derived this. Okay, whenever the equation of the plane pi 1 is nothing but r bar dot n cap is equal to d, where n cap is the unit normal vector. Suppose that we are given with the equation of the plane pi 1 as r dot n bar is equal to d, where n is the normal vector, not that, not a unit normal vector, but just a normal vector. Then the distance is given by, then the distance between the given point and plane pi 1 is given by modulus of, note that this is a very important result, modulus of a bar dot n minus d whole divided by modulus of n bar. Whenever, when we use this result, when the equation of the plane is of this form, r bar dot n bar is equal to d, where n bar is nothing but the normal vector. When n bar is the, when we are given an equation of the form this, where n cap is a unit normal vector, we use this equation. And when n bar is a just a normal vector, we use this equation. Very important. Therefore, we have, whenever a bar dot n bar is equal to d is the equation for the plane pi 1, then the distance between the point P and the pi 1 is given by this formula, isn't it? Now suppose that the plane pi 1 is given by a bar dot n bar is equal to d, whereas, sorry, let us name it as capital D. So this is the equation for pi 1. Now suppose that a bar is nothing but x 1, the point a bar is nothing but x1 I cap plus y1 j cap plus z1 k cap. That is, the point is nothing but, the point B is nothing but x1 y1 z, and then a bar is equal to this, isn't it? And suppose that n bar is given by a I cap plus b j cap plus c k cap, which means that the normal vector is given by this. Then the distance between the point A, the point A and n bar is given by this formula. What it will be? It will be x1 I cap plus y1 j cap plus z1 k cap dot n bar a I cap plus b j cap plus c k cap minus d, here small, not small d, capital D we used, so minus d whole divided by mod n bar. What is mod n bar? Square root of a square plus b square plus c square, isn't it? When we find cross product and reduce this into a normal form, we will get what? ax plus, sorry, ax1 plus by1 plus cz1 minus d divided by root of a square plus b square plus c square, and find the absolute value. This will be the Cartesian equation to find the distance of a point P from the plane pi 1, where a, b, c are the corresponding direction ratios of the normal vector, d is the equation distance of the plane from the origin, and we have x1, y1, z1 are nothing but the point P. Now we shall work out the example number 24 from your textbook. The question is that find the distance of the point 2,5 minus 3 from the plane r dot 6i cap minus 3j cap plus 2k cap equal to 4. We know that the distance of the point when it is given in the normal form is nothing but absolute value of ax1 plus by1 plus cz1 minus d divided by root of a square plus b square plus c square, isn't it? Where the equation of the plane is of the form rn cap, rn bar, r dot n bar is equal to d, isn't it? From the given equation, comparing these two equations, we shall easily identify that n bar is nothing but 6i cap minus 3j cap plus 2k cap, isn't it? And d is equal to 4. So substituting, and the point x1, y1 is at 1, x1, y1, z1 is given by 2, 5, minus 3, isn't it? So substituting all those values, we get the distance of the point is by ax1. What is a? 6. 6 into 2. ax1 plus by1. What is b? Plus minus 3 into 5. Minus 15. Plus cz1. What is c? So c is equal to 2. 2 into minus 3 equal to minus 6. Minus d. D is equal to minus 4 by square root of d is equal to 4. So minus d become minus 4 divided by 6 square plus 3 square plus 2 square equal to what? Absolute value of 12 minus 15 minus 6 minus 4 divided by, this is root 49. So we have 7 here. It is equal to 12 minus 15 is nothing but minus 3 minus 3. Minus 6 is minus 9, minus 9, minus 4 is equal to minus 13. Absolute value become 13. So 13 by 7 will be the distance of this point from this plane. So this is as simple as that. Just by heart the equation very well. So you can easily do this section. All the problems from this session. I think you can easily do all the problems from this session if you understand and by heart each and every equation very well. The terms used in the equation, the concept behind each equation, etc. So I hope you understood this concept very well. This is towards the end of our chapter, and in the next class we will solve the last exercise. Exercise 11.3 from this chapter. And till then, wait for the next class. Bye-bye.